Welcome on into Warchant TV. I'm Aslan Hunjavani, joined by founder and administrator of Warchant.com, the ultimate Seminoles sports source, Gene Williams. Promo code at the bottom of your screen. Hit the thumbs up button. Also, if you could, maybe even subscribe to our YouTube channel. That's in the lower right corner as well. Set the notifications with the little bell for however frequently or infrequently you'd like to perhaps be notified of these new videos dropping. All right, Gene, as we go through the wreckage, or mostly the success of signing day here, I guess one of the big questions that we have about Mike Norvell is his prowess when it comes to recruiting. I think a lot of fans like the way that he coaches and calls an offensive game plan. But coming off the 20th ranked class in 2020 and 28th class rather in 2021, that doesn't kind of jive up to with what Florida State fans think as being a good recruiter. But I would assume there's a lot of nuance in that sort of picture.
Yeah, even back the early signing period, I was getting a lot of people were asking me, like, well, like you said, I think we kind of like the direction he's going. We like what we hear about him, but I just don't think he's a good recruiter. And they look at that number you just pointed out. I think they were in the 30s until they got, obviously, Destin Hill to commit yesterday. But, I mean, when you look at that number, I mean, that's shocking. I mean, the modern era of Florida State, that's the lowest since they started doing recruiting rankings Florida State's ever had. So it's easy to come to that conclusion. But I started writing a column, which you can read in association with this on warchant.com, about reasons why actually Mike Norvell, all the signs point to him being a really good recruiter. I initially set out and say, here's some pros and cons, but every time I looked at it, I kept saying, no, this points to him being a good recruiter, and so on. So I came up with five reasons why he actually, him and his staff are really good recruiters. You know, some things are as simple as, look, they had 17 signees in the class. Well, the way Rivals and ESPN and these others rank, how big your class is makes a huge difference. So the fact that Florida State 17 has 17 commitments really pushes that class down. Because I look, if you go by the star average, and it's very unscientific, I think Nebraska is somewhere around 19, and they have that pretty much the same exact star rating as Florida State, but they've got 25, 26 commitments, whatever it is. So Florida State, even at the end of the day, is a borderline. You can find Nebraska on there where they are. Yeah, they're 19. So Florida State, you know, borderline top 20 signing class. They could have filled out those remaining, you know, seven scholarships and gotten all high school players. I mean, I actually see they're a little higher than Nebraska there. So, I mean, that weighs into it too. But I think the biggest thing when you look at this class is you have to consider the transfers. I mean, I don't care what you say. Florida State had a top five transfer class in the nation. I think when you put McKenzie Milton, Johnson, Bam, Moore, all those guys in there, you add them up, that's pretty darn good and hitting a lot of positions of need. So I did incredibly unscientific, Aslan, but what I did was, and you can maybe flash real quickly on that part, I don't want to give too much away, but I went ahead and gave my own star rankings because I asked Rivals to do it. They didn't want to do it. No one else, ESPN, no one else has done it for the transfers. Yeah. So I kind of went and said, what did these guys do? If we were to rank them as recruits, you know, what would we do with these guys? Where would they rank based on what they've done in high school, junior college, and obviously what they've done in college most recently? How would that weigh into it? Maybe, you know, I'm sure people are going to have some debate. Oh, this got to be a three-star or a four-star. You can say McKenzie Milton's damaged goods. He had to be a four-star. But, man, the numbers he put up in two seasons, how well he fits in that offense, if he's healthy, I have a hard time imagining any quarterback Florida State could have signed that could have come in year one and do what he could potentially do with this offense. So, anyway, I added all those up, added them into the class, and all those signees, and came up with an overall ranking. And it would be borderline top 10. I mean, you're talking about a top 10 recruiting class. And you say that, you throw all that in to a team that had three wins coming off two horrible seasons before that. So I think a coach that can do that, I think speaks volumes of how good he's doing.
And I think people might say, well, what if you factor in everybody else's recruits or transfers? Yeah. Nobody hit the transfer market like Mike Norvell did.
Look, I can't factor in everybody else's transfer net at all. I don't have an unlimited amount of time to do that. But like you said, it's one of the better recruiting classes for transfers. So maybe Florida State isn't borderline top 10. Maybe they're top 15. But at the end of the day, the point is, it's a heck of a lot better than number 28.
Yeah. And to your point about McKenzie Milton, I mean, didn't Josh Sweat keep his five-star ranking despite having a pretty gruesome injury that senior year of his in high school?
Absolutely. Now, he did drop from, I think, being the number one overall defensive end down a few spots, but still, he was a five-star guy at the end of the day, and, you know, he's doing pretty well in the NFL right now, so I think Rivals got that one right.
And another thing that we tangibly know of, Gene, is that the outreach that Mike Norvell had early on in his tenure here at Florida State was starting to build traction. We were out there for those first three spring practices before the pandemic set in, and the sidelines were just lined with recruits and high school coaches and high school coaches taking notes. They seemed to really be dialed into what was going on. So there's something to be said about that as well. Norvell touched on the fact that their hit rate with guys that actually got on campus was so high that that makes them feel pretty optimistic about the future. Just imagine when they're able to finally open the doors back up and get kids back on campus. Kids seem to do well around the staff. And then again, man, just to have high school coaches excited to be around this program, taking notes, kind of shows you what they believe about this program, and that trickles down to their players.
Yeah, that's on great minds. You mentioned my number four on my list of five things. But yeah, because I went back and looked and I listed. I mean, they had the two junior days then too. So the two junior days, and they got three practices before the pandemic shut everything out. I went back and looked. I listed a lot of the guys. There's a lot of highly regarded recruits that came through. And the fact that he was getting those guys to come in to campus tells you, like, you if you're not a good recruiter, you're not getting 4- and 5-star guys to come visit your campus. You're just not. So that's the first step in recruiting, is to get them in the door. And he got a lot of those guys to show up. And there's a picture right there. You can see this was a daily occurrence during those early practices. You were out there. I was out there. Wherever you looked on the sideline, it was packed wall to wall with these recruits. They were all over the place. And you can't imagine if he had the time to have those guys through there, through, think of all the summer camps that could have had all the guys on campus. I have no doubt that he would have formed more relationships and signed more elite prospects. And we've been looking at a much higher ranked class right now. So, I mean, again, I know people are going to say, well, it's an excuse. But no, the pandemic from first year head coaches really tied their hands behind their back.
And I mean, again, I tripped over it. You know, in 2020, his first year here, they were the 20th ranked class. Right now, they're ranked 28th. But looking ahead to the future, I mean, they're starting to build traction there with the 2022 class. I mean, the caliber of player that he was able to get, not only a guy like Mackenzie Milton, who's probably going to be a highly sought after guy when he made himself available, but a guy like Jermaine Johnson, who went the tough route through JUCO, was playing at a high level program like Georgia. I mean, this shows you that he's able to recruit all kinds of different players from different backgrounds, different skill sets, to a different caliber of player. I mean, that has to kind of pretend to a guy that is a good recruiter, no?
Yeah, I mean, he's rated the SEC. I mean, think of all the guys from South Carolina and Georgia and Arkansas that all came in as transfers. I mean, you don't think those guys had a lot of other options to go to other Power 5 schools? So they came to Florida State for a reason. I mean, because Mike Norvell and his staff, I mean, were on these guys. They believed in their vision. They believed they could play and be coached up here, and they wouldn't have done that otherwise. And to that, take that further, go ahead and start looking at 2022 already. They've gotten some big commitments there. And I know, and that's number five on my list, and I know it's incredibly early, but if you're a bad recruiter, you're not getting 5-stars and 4-star quarterbacks to come this early in the process. The fact that they already have the number five ranked recruiting class, I know Michael Langston was on the recruiting show you guys did, and someone asked, and he said, I wouldn't be surprised if it ends up being top 10. You know, and I point out in the column that a lot's going to depend on what happens on the field. If they get three wins again, all bets are off.
Absolutely.
But assuming we see some tangible improvement on the field, that's going to legitimize what he's doing. And I think that's going to, if anything, that might open you up to more recruits that maybe right now are like, Florida State doesn't look real good. They only got three wins. They're blown out. You know, they go out there, they competitive. Maybe they beat a Notre Dame. Maybe they beat a Miami. You know, they get bowl eligible, and some kids might go, wait, looks like Mike Norvell's got some good stuff going on there. You know, especially, let's say, offensively, McKenzie blows it up, and they're putting some wide receivers, some tight ends, some offensive linemen start wanting to roll in here, and you got the ball rolling again. So I think this is a really good sign. They've got that momentum. You've obviously got Marvin Jones Jr. You've got the Armella. You know, you got some other really highly regarded recruits that aren't committed that Florida State's got a really good shot at for 2022 as well. So, man, there's a lot of positive signs of recruiting for Florida State.
So then I guess in closing, Gene, do you think you have a pretty good grasp, at least when people start asking you now about whether or not he's a good recruiter? I know you could simply tell them, hey, go to my website and look at the story I did. But when you have these conversations now with fans that, you know, might have been, you know, biting their teeth and worrying about whether or not he can be a good recruiter, do you think, you know, a full year now under the belt, there's a little more clarity even amidst the pandemic?
Yeah, I think there is. I mean, honestly, I had this early on, and when he first came on, and remember, he was doing some of these events in cities with high school coaches, really reaching out to form those relationships, was something, you know, Willie Taggart didn't do. And you talk to some of these high school coaches off the record, man, they couldn't stop raving about Mike Norvell. He'd get up on the chalkboard and show them stuff and what they're going to do. And there's only, you see those guys. I mean, you used to do it with Jimbo all the time. And one thing, look, he had his personality issues, But Mayo, when he wanted to talk football and he would get up there and talk X's and O's, you were impressed. And it's, you know, he does, he has the same impact with high school coaches. They believe what he's doing. We know he's as organized as all get out. And now he's reaching out and has that personality. It resonates with the coaches. And that means it's also going to resonate with the parents and the recruits. So it's just a matter of getting to meet the kids in person and then showing a product on the field. And I think you'll see what a good recruiter he is.
There we go. As you pointed out, this is part of a larger look picture of a column that's up right now on warchant.com, the five takes from our own Gene Williams. So go over to warchant.com, check it out, use that promo code warchant30. If you're not already a member, head over to the premium recruiting board, ask your questions to Michael Langston. He'll answer them as well. And we'll be having a happy hour later on Thursday, so we'll take your questions then. So I guess we'll see you then, huh, Gene?
That sounds good, man. The beer's chilling, Aslan.
That sounds good. For Gene, I'm Aslan. Thanks so much for watching.